So we're going to rip into it. We don't need to give him a big introduction. Everyone here knows who Ruslan Kogan is. Absolutely kicking ass in business. So, mate, let's jump straight into it. Tell us about you. Tell us about how you got started.
Well, that's a fairly open-ended question there. It all started in 1982, November 28th.
Hey.
Thank you. Look, there's... I used to tell a startup story, and it started in 2006 when I registered the business. And then I realized recently that it actually started in 1989 when my parents fled the communist Soviet Union and moved to Australia. And I was at where I realized this was an Entrepreneur of the Year evening, and it was one of those swanky dinners where, round table gala dinner night with five knives and forks and you don't know which one to use. And I look at the plaque in the middle of the table, which had all the finalists for Entrepreneur of the Year, and all of the names were Russian. And at that point I thought, shit, I haven't bribed any of the judges. There's no chance I'm winning this one. And then somehow won it. They must have counted the bribes wrong. And I got up on stage and I pointed out to the MC that all the finalists were Russian. And he said, why do you think that is? And I was like, I don't know, no idea. Maybe vodka's got something to do with it. And then he asked me about what business skills I've learned from my parents. And I said, well, none at all. My parents grew up in a communist country. They don't know any business skills whatsoever. And like my mum would, we used to live in the housing commission flats in Elstonwick, and she'd drive to Dandenong to buy fruit and veg. And I'd be like, mum, why are you doing that? And she'd say, oh, well, it's cheaper in Dandenong. And I said, well, really? Have you taken opportunity cost into account, the petrol it takes you to get there, the time it takes you to get there, the time you could have otherwise spent at work? It's cheaper to go to Coles up the top of the street and buy fruit and veg there. But my parents had no business skills, no sense of opportunity cost or supply and demand and things like that. So I said, nah, my parents didn't teach me any business skills. And then I got off stage. An elderly gentleman came up to me and he said, you got a lot more business skills from your parents than you think. And I said, well, how so? And he said, think about what it takes to be an immigrant. You've got to drop everything you've got, take a massive risk, travel into the unknown, and work your ass off for a potential benefit that might not even be there. And think about what it takes to be an entrepreneur. You've got to drop everything you've got, take a massive risk, travel into the unknown and work your ass off for a potential benefit that might not even be there. And at that point, I realized that coming to Australia at the age of 5 and a half, seeing my parents go through immigration, they landed here with $90 in their pocket, trying to raise two kids, working 3 to 4 jobs each. My mum would be a cleaner at one cafe, a waitress at another. Dad would work at the Victoria markets, then deliver pizzas, then deliver pamphlets. You know, so seeing that work ethic, the determination, the learning played a massive part in where I am today. So I'd say that's how I got started.
Great. So you grew up in Melbourne. You obviously went to Melbourne when you were a youngster.
Yeah, so grew up in Melbourne, started off living in the Housing Commission flats in Elstonwick, went to Caulfield North Primary, then Elstonwick Primary, then Brighton High, then Melbourne High. So yeah, Melbourne's home.
Yeah, great. So you obviously, like all of us, went through school and got to the end of that and decided to graduate and went to the corporate world. So what was that transition like? And obviously, where did you go and what did you do?
Yeah, so I'd run about 20 businesses since the age of 9. So from a very young age, I knew that if I want something, I'm going to have to go out there and earn it myself. So, you know, they weren't massive. Like, the first thing I did was, near the Housing Commission flats, there was a golf course, and each time I'd walk to tennis practice, I'd see golf balls along the fence line. So then I walked into the pro shop one day and saw that they're selling golf balls that are secondhand for $2 each. So I'd pick up all the golf balls on the way to tennis and back that all the lazy golfers couldn't be bothered picking up, take them home, wash them, put them in egg cartons, go back and sell them to the golfers at the weekend. And it wasn't huge money, it was like $10 or $20 a weekend, but at the age of 9, that makes you pimp at the milk bar. So yeah, so, you know, there were always ventures along the way, but I always had a passion for technology and IT. And I finished top of the state in IT in year 12, and then thought I'd use that to get a head start in an IT career. So after year 12, I sent a letter, I went through the yellow pages and sent a letter to every single IT company in Melbourne saying, look, I want to prove myself, I'm happy to work for free, and not a single one responded. So I went on to do a Bachelor of BS at Monash, Business Systems. So as part of that degree, we had a, you know, IMLP in, or no, it was IBL, industry-based learning thing, which is basically another name for cheap labor for corporate organizations, yeah. So I worked for Bosch and GE. Then when I finished uni, I had a unique skill set at the time. So I in my spare time, I did a CCIE, which is Cisco Certified Internet Working Engineer. So by the time I finished uni, I got a job on 150K a year at GE. But, you know, it got very boring quickly. It's basically like connecting computer networks and stuff. And I knew it pretty well. It wasn't exciting. I wasn't jumping out of bed in the morning. And then Accenture started marketing to me for their consulting roles. And they'd send me these glossy brochures showing like consultants on laptops in parks, and these glossy brochures. And I thought, you know, that's what I want to be doing. I want to be one of those consultants in a park on a laptop. But Accenture was paying like 40 grand a year. So, you know, everyone told me, oh, you're stupid, stay at GE. Why would you leave GE? And I thought, no, I have to. And I quit and went to Accenture. And not once did I get to work in a park on a laptop. They're the McDonald's of smart people. It's, yeah. Is anyone here from Accenture? Sweet. Yeah. Well, no, it's a very process-driven organization. They, like, have a process for everything. You do step one, step 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4A, 1.4B. And I was, like, telling my managers, I'm like, hey, you lured me in on this innovative workplace and all this innovation going on everywhere, and how are we meant to innovate if you've got a process for everything? And the managers would tell me, oh, the innovation comes through how you follow the process. And that's a concept I never really understood. Like, they actually even had a diagram in the bathrooms showing you how to go to the toilet step by step. No shit. Your taxpayer money actually pays for the diagram. It's on the Victorian government website. But there's a printout that people telling them how to go to the toilet. But yeah, I wasn't enjoying Accenture very much.
Cool. So if you take one step back in that, you briefly touched on when you left GE to go to Accenture. You'll make 150 a year, and you were going to switch it and go to 40 grand. And your mates were like, no, don't do it. Stay with the security. Did you find that? Because I know there's a lot of people in the room that are in corporate that obviously want to switch into being an entrepreneur. How did you find that? Was there much pressure there, or did you just tell me you're
going to
do it anyway?
Yeah, look, it would have been the same pressure as when I was at Accenture and wanted to start Kogan, because everyone told me that, oh no, it's not going to work, nobody's going to buy TVs online's for books and CDs, investors told me that nobody's going to buy a TV without seeing it first. My mum started crying saying, you know, you've got a great education, a great job, and now you're going to be a TV salesman. You know, so I guess the decision from GE to Accenture helped me with that decision as well, because I thought, well, at the end of the day, your sole goal in life is happiness and personal happiness. And there's only one person in the world who knows what makes you happy, and there's only one person in the world responsible for making you happy. So when I made the switch from GE to Accenture, I was like, well, look, I'm not jumping out of bed in the morning. I don't enjoy this. I'm not willing to go through this grind for the rest of my life just because other people think it's the right thing to do. I need to make moves. And it's the same thing that happened when I decided to leave Accenture and start the business, because I wasn't enjoying it. And I had an idea that I think would work. Yes, it might fail. Yes, other people think that it won't work, but I'm not here to please other people. Like, I wasn't jumping out of bed in the morning.
Sure. So take us through leaving Accenture and obviously moving into Kogan. Where did the idea come from? And what caused the jump? What was the transition?
Yeah, so at Accenture, I was on a project. So a few things happened at the same time. So I was on a project at Accenture up in Newcastle, and we were doing a data migration project. And there were about 10 grads on the project, and it involved moving data from one system to another. And they broke the data up and gave us 10,000 rows each and said, well, convert it from this format to this format. And they wanted us to do it manually. And they gave us a task on a Monday morning and said it had to be done by Friday. I took the task back to my desk, looked at the data, found a few patterns in it, wrote a script, and had it, the whole task completed by 9:30 a.m. that Monday. I went back to my manager and I showed it to her and I said, look, I've finished the task. We don't need to spend a whole week on this. I can show all the other grads how to do it quicker and we can move on to something else. And she was like, oh, don't worry about it. She was like, no, you couldn't have done it properly. Go back to your desk. And I was like, no, I have done it properly. She's like, no, do it properly, then show it to me. And I was like, I've checked it, I've done it properly. And she was just refusing to look at it. She said, there's no way you can have this task done by 9:30 a.m. So it was a bit demoralizing. I put my head down, walked back to my desk. But luckily I was selling a few things on eBay here and there at the time. So I thought, oh, well, a week on eBay. At pretty much the same time, I'd always been into gadgets, and I was the kid in school who had a new phone every 2 months, and I wanted a flat panel TV because at the time they were shit hot. And I went into a few stores, and even though I was earning some decent coin, I couldn't afford one. So I went and sent emails to all these factories out of Asia that made LCD TVs. And it was like, you know, hi, please quote me on 100,000 units of this TV and that TV. And, you know, was getting quotes for TVs. My goal at the time was purely that once they reply with a quote, I'd ask them for a sample and that would be my TV. When they started replying, I started to see, well, hang on a second. While there's hundreds of TV brands in the world, there's only four panel manufacturers, Samsung, LG, Hitachi, and Sharp. They make the majority of the big screen panels. So the panel makes up 90% of the cost of the TV. So essentially, all TVs are same shit, different smell. And I thought, well, all right, if that's the case, and they're all pretty much the same, why can I land a TV for $1,000 that other stores are selling for $3,000 or $4,000? That's a huge opportunity in the market. And I knew that online retail is all about maximum value per cubic centimeter. Like, if any of you thinking of selling water tanks online, don't do it. Because by the time you send one from Melbourne to Sydney, it'll cost you more than the water tank. So here you had a small, thin box with a valuable product in it, and I thought, you know, this is going to work. And that's when I started taking it seriously, and I went around to everyone, and that's when they all told me, nah, no one's going to buy a TV online. And I was like, well, what if there's reviews online, and there's specs online, and there's a money-back guarantee? People are like, no one's going to buy a TV online. So
what year was this?
This was 2003.
Right.
Yeah, so I decided that Wednesday I went into Accenture and I wanted to, like, I'm still risk averse. I don't want to take risks that don't need to be taken. So I went to my manager and I said to her, look, I'm going through a few personal issues at the moment. Can I have 1 year leave without pay? And she said, no, we don't do leave without pay. You've barely been here for a year, blah, 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 blah. And I said, well, look, in that case, I resign. and I know I'm meant to give 28 days notice. I've never broken an agreement in my life, but if we can shorten that period in any way, I'd really appreciate it. I'm happy to work 7 days a week. I'm happy to do whatever handover you want me to do. I'm happy to do whatever it takes to shorten that period of notice. And she said to me, like, oh, don't worry about it, just finish up today. So I knew I wasn't really appreciated there, but I had no idea to what extent.
Sound familiar?
Yeah. So that was a Wednesday. By Sunday, Kogan was up and running.
Great. And so tell us how it's one of my favorite things I've heard you talk about. Tell us how you got the money together to actually get the first lot of TVs, to get the order.
Yeah, so I started, you know, I built the website and everything, and everything was ready to go. The few investors I'd spoken to thought it's a crap idea, so there wasn't really any point in pursuing it with them. And I thought, well, you know, I've got no money. You need to pay a deposit to get an order started in China. And around the same time, my mum was shopping for furniture. So she said, can you come and help me buy a dining room table and haggle on the price, get the price reduced a bit? And I said, sure. I went along to the shop with my mom. I haggled with the guy, got her a cheaper price on the dining room table. We went up to the counter. It was like $5,000. She gave him her credit card, paid for it. The guy was like, okay, you'll have the table in 45 to 60 days. She was like, thank you so much. And he was like, oh, you're gonna love the table. And she was like, oh, thank you so much. And we walked out of the store and I was like, mum, you just paid for something you're not gonna have for 2 months. And you've paid in full up front for that dining room table. And she goes to me, yeah, that's just how it works. And I thought, all right, if that's just how it works, and that's just how it works. So I went back to the website I built and I put a delivery date of 45 days ahead for all the TVs, knowing that manufacturing them will take about 25 days, about 15 days for shipping and 5 days of slack time. And I did a Google AdWords campaign for it. I listed all the TVs on eBay and they started selling. So everything was going great guns. And I hadn't even paid the deposit to China yet, but money was flowing into the bank account. The eBay sales were generating a lot of attention for Kogan because I was doing something very different to what everyone else was doing, and I had 1 cent no reserve auctions. And people were like, oh, you know, what if a TV ends for 10 cents? And I was like, well, does that mean nobody's willing to pay 15 cents? Like, if you have a free natural market, which is what eBay is, and a product that's in demand or at least two people want it, you're going to get the correct natural market price for it. You know, basics of supply and demand. So I knew that the strategy is flawless. There were thousands or hundreds of thousands of people that wanted a flat panel TV. But what this did to all the eBay auctions is it caused them to get, you know, tens of thousands of views and thousands of watches on each auction, and it generated a lot of hype on the internet, and all the blogs and forums were talking about Kogan. At the same time on the website, I got a 1-300 number. Because, you know, everyone thinks if you've got a 1-300 number, fuck, you're massive, like Telstra. It costs like 15 bucks. I had it diverted to my mobile. And I'd answer all the calls with like, you know, thanks for calling Kogan, this is Tim. Thanks for calling Kogan, this is Peter. And on the emails, I'd reply with chicks' names. So it would be like, you know, thank you for your inquiry, kindest regards, Lucy at Kogan. Thanks for your inquiry, kindest regards, Sarah at Kogan. Nobody ever complains to a chick. It got weird. There were a few weird scenarios where the guy was like, oh, look, keep my money for delivery, but I'll come to the warehouse and pick up the TV and bring you flowers. And then you send them an auto responder, like, you know, Sarah is on leave at the moment. So everything was going really well until I got a nasty email from eBay saying, you know, dear Mr. Kogan, we've noticed some irregular selling activity on your account. You've sold a high volume of products for which you have not received any feedback. We view your account as high risk. We have suspended your account until you receive feedback for these items. And I was like, shit, because that's a key sales channel I was relying on. Because by this stage I'd already paid a deposit to China because sales were coming through. I got the first bit of money, paid a deposit, and then I was relying on sales happening really quickly in order for me to be able to pay the balance to China. But yeah, eBay shut down the account, then got an even nastier email from PayPal saying pretty much the same thing, but we've frozen all the funds in your account until you get feedback for the items. And I thought, shit, why didn't I just withdraw the money the day before? But basically I was up shit creek without a paddle now, because I had funds locked up in PayPal. I had an eBay account which was deactivated and I couldn't sell any more TVs. And I'd pre-sold TVs that I had to deliver to customers, and I wasn't going to be able to get the balance payment in time to pay China. And luckily, this being 2006, it's when they were giving credit cards to every man and his dog, the banks, including the NAB, and they made a contribution to me. So. I thought, well, I need money quick. So I went online and I configured my Firefox browser to very quickly be able to fill out credit card application forms. And I could do it in under a minute, you know, I was auto-filling the forms, looking for banner ads for credit cards, clicking them, applying, click apply, click apply. And within a week, an unemployed 23-year-old received about 50 grand worth of credit cards. So I thought, sweet, and I was still about 30 grand short, so I told a few friends what I've done and said, guys, can you help me out? And it's really easy to get credit cards, this is what you do. And and my mates went on and they got credit cards. They knew that giving me money is as good as money in the bank, and they'd known me for a long time, so they got the money, the credit cards as well, went into a bank, took a full cash advance on every single credit card, and then I paid the balance payment to China. But at this point, my balls were on the line, so I couldn't afford for anything to go wrong. I owed my friends money, I owed customers TVs, I owed the banks money as well through the credit cards, so I jumped on a plane and flew to China. And I arrived at the factory and personally inspected every single TV at the component level. You know, and they found it a bit weird that the guy who given them a founder and CEO business card is down on all fours testing the TVs, but I didn't give a shit what they thought. I had a job that had to get done, nothing could go wrong, tested every TV, watched them get loaded in the container, watched them seal the container, then I probably took it one step too far. And I jumped in a taxi and paid him to follow the truck with the container to the shipping yard. Now, I'd probably seen one too many Hollywood movies. I have no idea what I would have done if dudes with AKs attacked the container. But the container got to the shipping yard fine. I went back to the hotel room, packed my shit, caught the next flight, and then sat in Melbourne for 15 days waiting for the container to arrive. It was the slowest 15 days of my life. And the container finally arrived, slapped shipping labels on the TVs, sent them to customers. They all left positive feedback. eBay re-enabled the account, PayPal released the funds. I paid my friends back, I paid the credit cards off, and I made a bit of profit. And that meant that the next container didn't have to be a 45-day pre-sale, it was a 30-day pre-sale. The container after that was a 15-day pre-sale. Container after that, we started to have stock. Now we've got we've just got a new warehouse. I'm trying to calculate it. We've got over 48,000 square meters of warehouse space in Melbourne, Sydney, Hong Kong, London, chock-a-block full of consumer electronics, and over 300 containers on the water at any time, and not a single cent of external funding.
Awesome. So that, it worked.
Yeah.
So take us through the next phase. Where did you go from I mean, obviously you got your first bunch of sales, that was great. And how have you grown the Kogan brand? And we'll touch on bits and pieces, but take us through the next stage.
Yeah, so look, the growth happened, a lot of it was organic. There wasn't anything, like, I get a lot of people say like, oh, you know, you've become an overnight success, Kogan's everywhere now. And I'm like, yeah, it took me 8.5 years to become an overnight success, or even 32 years to become an overnight success. So, you know, a lot of it was organic growth. There wasn't anything like, boom, massive. The biggest, you know, our marketing was digital. It was very scientific how we did it. We didn't have money to waste. Probably our first ever Today Tonight story was a massive boost to the business. I had no idea how many people watched that stuff. I remember trying to get that story as well, because I was slowly learning about the media game, because I went and explained to Today Tonight. I was like, oh, look, we've got this business model where we've re-engineered the supply chain and cut out the middleman in order to bring savings to the consumer, and they just weren't interested at all, because they're obviously targeting a very specific demographic. So I was like, how do I pitch this to Today Tonight? Then I contacted them one morning and I said, you know, TVs from 1 cent. And they were in my office by 10 a.m. So you gotta know how to come up with the right angle, because our eBay auctions were starting at 1 cent, no reserve. Technically, you could get a TV for 1 cent if you were the only person in Australia who wanted one. So I was starting to learn about the PR game, which I've become pretty good at since then.
Totally. So let's talk about your best mate, Jerry Harvey. So one of the things that Ruslan's amazing at is disrupting. And you often hear a lot of that in startups. And you've definitely disrupted the retail market in Australia, taken a huge chunk of it, really. So tell us about how you did that, because I mean, Jerry Harvey's constantly on TV screaming about you, isn't he? So how did you do that? How did you get in there and disrupt it?
The Jerry Harvey's a funny one, because growing up, and I still do, listen to a lot of rap, and I loved Eminem. And I remember Eminem was in a battle with Ja Rule, and Eminem would do a diss, and then Ja Rule would do a diss, and then Eminem, and then Ja Rule, and they went back and forward for probably a year. And I was always downloading them and listening to them, and you know, and Eminem ended the battle by saying, you know, I'm not gonna respond anymore. I've sold you more records than you could ever sell yourself. So that stuck in my head. That was still probably when I was in college in Miami that ended. So after that, I was thinking, you know, oh, if I can get a response out of Jerry, that'd be exactly what Ja Rule managed to do to Eminem. And I was filming a Today Tonight story, and every time the cameras were off, I would tell the journal, I was like, oh, you should ask Jerry what he thinks of these prices. He would not be happy. He would not be happy. He'd look at him and go, oh, like, oh, you should ask Jerry. Whew. Oh, I wonder what he'd say if you showed him this, you know, like, I was like the kid in the play yard, like, you know, trying to instigate a fight, saying, oh, do you hear what he said about your mum? You know, like. So I was doing that to the journal, and then that story airs that night, and in the middle of the story, all of a sudden, I see Jerry with a printout of our website going, oh, they're not that much cheaper than us. Beautiful. You know, Jerry there with a printout of a website. Like, couldn't ask for a better platform to launch from. And then it just blew up from there. You know, someone, Todd Sampson on the Gruen transfer, correctly said that somebody should have been telling him, no, Jerry, no. Steer clear of that. But yeah, he took the bait, and it's worked out well. Realistically, when all of that went on, we were a pimple on the ass of the industry. We were tiny. We were $8 million a year business, with Harvey Norman being, I don't know, 4 or 5 or 6 bill. Like, we were insignificant. And at our growth rate at the moment, if current market trends continue, we could be bigger than them in 3 to 4 years.
Wow, that's fantastic. So take us, let's talk about, I mean, there's been a lot of success in it, and it's, let's talk about some of the struggles that you've gone through, because every entrepreneur has the grind. So take us through some of the struggles and growing pains that you've had, because you guys have had explosive growth. Yeah, take us through some of the struggles. Yeah.
I think it's all in the terminology, like, one man's struggle is another man's challenge. So I wouldn't quite call them struggles, but there's been a lot of learning experiences along the way, and stuff that when you look back at it, you think, oh, well, I'd do that differently now. For instance, the Kogan.com domain. When I started the business, I bought Kogan.com.au. Didn't even occur to me to buy Kogan.com. I could have had it for $14. You know, but we recently paid a sum with a lot of zeros on the end of it for that domain. So you learn things along the way. Now when we're even like thinking of something before we've even taken a minute step towards it, we've got every possible domain registered. You know, securing your intellectual property has been one of the things. But there's, in business, you make thousands of decisions every day and you're bound to get a few wrong. And the most important thing is that you look at it as a learning experience. That every decision or everything you got wrong, you're a better business because of it. So a few that come to mind. August 2008, we had massive shipments of TVs arrive in time for the Beijing Olympic Games. And it was a few days before the Olympics that the containers got here, cracked them open, sent all the TVs out to customers. Very quickly realized that there was a problem with those TVs and the sound on them would fail after continuous use. It could happen after a week, it could happen after 6 months, but there were problems where the sound would stop working on the TVs. We engaged engineers all over the country to go to the homes of these people and replace the sound cards in the TVs. It cost us hundreds of thousands, or if not millions of dollars, to rectify the problem. Basically, all the profit Kogan had made up until August 2008 was used to fix this problem, because our most valuable asset is our brand. We could not have somebody sitting there watching the opening ceremony and lose sound halfway through it. So it cost us a lot, but then straight after that, we were like, what went wrong here? And we implemented processes where now we've got age testing on every single TV. Every single TV now runs for 48 hours in various humidity and temperature conditions before being put in a box. So it'll be at everything from 4 degrees all the way through to 50 degrees, and shake testing, vibration testing, like a vigorous process that goes on now before shipping any unit. So, you know, you grow as a business because of it. So that's one example. Another one is a few years ago, we had a deal going live at midnight. It was for a quirky product. It was one of those coffee lens mugs. And the deal went live on midnight. We were discounting it from $25 to $15. And somehow there was a bug in the website, or somebody entered something incorrectly, and the discount got applied twice. So it went from $25 to $5. Now, these cost us at $15, we would have broken even. So, 15 bucks was break even. So at $5, we're losing 10 bucks a unit. By the time we'd woken up at 7 a.m., we've got our alerts on our phones that we'd sold something like 10,000 units and sold out by 3 a.m. So it got onto those tight ass forums, the Ozbargain. It got onto Ozbargain and, just went nuts on there, and the sale just went ballistic. And, well, we were then faced with a dilemma. Do we hide behind our terms and conditions? because we can refuse any order we want to, essentially. But we said, no, once again, the Kogan brand is the most valuable thing we've got. We copped the loss of $100,000. We shipped all of the orders, but implemented systems to ensure that nothing like that can happen again. So, you know, there's struggles or challenges that happen along the way, but you've just got to make sure that you look at them as a learning experience, and what doesn't kill you makes you stronger.
Absolutely. So let's talk about some more of your PR stuff. Recently you did obviously you've done partnerships with people like organisations like Collingwood, which obviously have a big following in Melbourne. You have the Collingwood TVs. Take us through some of the PR things you've done. Tell us about the recent one with Beards and the iPhone 6.
Yeah. Collingwood was an interesting one because I'm an Essendon supporter. So I had the idea a while ago to do a club branded TV, because what do footy supporters do? They watch a lot of TV. If they're not at the game, they're watching the game on a TV. And look, footy clubs are used to having branded scarves or footballs or what do you call them? The beer things,
the stubby holders.
Yeah, you know, all of that stuff. They're used to pens, hats, all of that. They're not used to a TV. It's never been done anywhere in the world before. So I was approaching Essendon for close to 2 years trying to convince them, let's do a co-branded TV. It'll be branded Essendon TV by Kogan. The supporters will love it. Let's do that. I was getting nowhere because nobody's ever lost their job for doing the same thing as the last guy. You know, so nobody wants to take the risk. And then I was chatting to Eddie one day and I mentioned it to him and he was like, let's do it. And within a few days it was done. So I felt bad about it, but the good thing was, a few weeks after launching the Collingwood TV, we launched an Essendon TV. So they saw it and they got onto it, which is, look, Essendon TV is much easier to do. When we launched the Collingwood one, we had to beef up security at our warehouse. So, the Essendon one was much easier to do, and now we've done a Geelong one as well, and I forgot the rest of your question.
That's right. So tell us, I saw recently a campaign that you guys did, and it had to do with beards around Melbourne.
So when the iPhone 6 launched, I don't know if any of you guys have noticed, but at Kogan we now, we've gone through a bit of a rebranding in the last year. So Kogan.com is now the brand of the retailer. Kogan's the brand of our consumer electronics products. But now we've got products in many, many verticals. It includes stuff like Komodo for outdoor and camping, Serta for power tools. I'll stop with the plugs. One of the brands is Scharfen, which is shaving equipment and shavers. And when all this publicity happened around the iPhone with people complaining that it's pulling their beard hairs out, the moment I saw that, I thought, oh, perfect platform. You know, iPhone with a free shaver, definitely never been done. So a few hours later, we launched that campaign and it got a bit of attention worldwide. And yeah, love doing that sort of stuff.
A whole bunch of trendy hipsters bought it.
Yeah, yeah. The PR was, centered around hipsters. So yeah, it was good.
Of course, so obviously now the brand's booming. I wanted to look at two different contrasts. So let's take it back 6-7 years when you were working flat out in your business at a micro level. Take us through the difference between that and now operationally at a macro level. Have you been able to delegate out a lot of the, obviously you have because you've grown, but take us through the different contrasts of now being at the macro to the micro.
I wish some of my staff were here to be able to help answer that question, but I wouldn't quite say I've taken myself out of the micro stuff. Like, it's very common for them to get an email at 3 a.m. going, why the fuck's there a full stop missing in this subject line, and why is this image from that perspective, and why is that? Like, I I would still have a say over 90% of subject lines you see in our newsletters and the copy and stuff and the way that a product is launched and every release and what products we do, what products we don't do. I can still take a TV apart to the component level for you and put it back together. So I'm very involved in the micro, and I keep getting told that I have to, you know, distance myself from it and let the people do their job, but I can't have a subject line go out incorrectly or the wrong key message being communicated about a product, or, you know, have two of the same chairs in different colours but shown from a different perspective on each one with no consistency, or sentence case here and non-sentence case here, or numbers not right aligned. Like, I fucking hate people who don't right align numbers. Like, you know, the numbers are meant to be right aligned to the same number of decimal places, and people center them. I don't get it. But yeah, I'm still very involved at the micro level in the business.
I take it you've graduated from going to China and inspecting the TVs, though?
Don't do the inspection of the TVs, but I'm still in China every few months, you know, meeting with a lot of our key manufacturing partners. We now work with over 300 factories in China. I would have a dinner at least once a year with about 30 of them. So yeah, but I'm not on all fours testing stuff to the component level anymore, but I still go there frequently. I'm a computer geek at heart. I still love the gadget side of the business and playing with the new gadgets and stuff like that. So, like, you know, you can find me these days at Albert Park flying my drone all over the place. Like, that's, I feel like a little boy again with that thing. It's exciting stuff.
That's great. So with are we gonna do some questions, Chris? Do you want to roll into some stuff that we've got up here? You want to ask them?
Yeah, sure. So can Kogan be a global player, or will you just focus on the Australian market?
Can it be a large global player? Well, are you allowed to ask a sentence with can at a NAB function?
Touché, very good.
We're already in 15 countries. We've got a decent sized operation in the UK, warehouse and distribution facilities there. We're in UK, Australia, New Zealand, and 12 other countries. So it's growing very quickly in whatever markets we're in. But Australia's our passion. Like, one of the goals of the business was to reinvent retail in Australia. Australia's a market where people have become accustomed to getting screwed. Like, when an Aussie goes overseas, and say an Australian goes to Paris and they come back, you're like, oh, how was it? What did you buy? You know, we're so used to being screwed that going overseas is about going shopping. You know, when an American goes to Paris, their mates say, oh, how was the Eiffel Tower? Like, we're so used to being screwed. Like, even you look now, even at our duty free, everyone's buying. No one's, they're so conditioned to traveling is when you get the best prices that they're not even processing the fact that everything is cheaper at Dan Murphy every single day of the week than duty free. It should be called duty free but higher margin. Like, so yeah, we can definitely be a global player, and you know, our home base will always be Australia. What a lot of people don't realise is that the most efficient retailer in the world is right in our backyard. Because if you ask people, you know, what's the most efficient retailer in the world, they'll say Amazon, but they're actually the second most efficient retailer in the world. They do $673,000 of sales per employee. Kogan does over $2 million. So our base is home. Our base is Australia. Australia's home. We're Aussies, but it will be a global company.
How many employees you got?
Good question.
Next question.
What's next for Kogan in the next 10 years?
Whoa. That's a tough question. I don't like people send me a calendar invite for something next month, and I'm like, I don't know what I'm doing tomorrow, let alone next month. So we've got a lot of growth coming at the moment from two areas, and you know they're not surprising areas because there's only two ways you can grow any business. You either find more customers or you sell your existing customers more stuff. There's no other ways to grow a business, and we're doing both of those. So we're doing significant category expansion. We're not just consumer electronics anymore. We're in pretty much any category you can think of. And we're expanding globally as well and finding, you know, more customers in more markets while still growing at a very rapid pace in Australia. So, you know, that's our outlook for now at least. 10 years is longer than Kogan's even existed for. So, it's a long outlook.
Events like this are great for inspiration. As an established entrepreneur, what or who inspires you?
Yeah, my parents, they're, like I said before, you know, I used to think that I didn't get any business skills from them, but just even now, starting to understand what they would have gone through in immigration and, you know, the times that they made me study and the times that, you know, the importance they put on education and watching them work as many jobs as they did, they're my inspiration, definitely.
Can I ask a question, Chris? We talked about this before. What do you think the biggest difference between someone who is an employee working in employment, the mindset of someone who, the difference between an employee and an entrepreneur? What do you think the biggest shift is that people have to have?
Mm-hmm. The first thing there is that entrepreneurship's not for everyone. Like, it's become really cool since the Social Network movie came out. And everybody wants to be an entrepreneur after that movie, which is weird because I didn't watch Spider-Man and want to become a spider. So there's a lot of people who want to do it at the moment, but I still get these weird questions. Like, I'll have people come to me after an event and they're like, oh, I want to be an entrepreneur, but I'm really scared of risk and uncertainty and it just freaks me out and I get panic attacks and anxiety. What do you recommend I do? It's like, how the fuck are those two aligned? Like, like, what made you think that you want to be an entrepreneur if that's the stuff that really scares you? It's like, oh, you know, I want to be a world champion swimmer, but I'm shit scared of water. Or I want to be the hot dog eating champion, but I'm allergic to pork. Like, you know, it's not meant for everyone. And then there's other misconceptions as well, where I have people come up to me and they're like, oh, you know what, I want to be an entrepreneur. I'm so sick and tired of the 40-hour week. Last time I worked 40 hours was at Accenture. Or the other one is like, I'm sick and tired of reporting to someone. I want to be an entrepreneur. I went from reporting to one manager at Accenture to reporting to over 80 million people now. So, you know, there's all of these misconceptions in the marketplace about it. It comes down to what you want to do, what makes you happy, what are you passionate about. And some people enter it also because they do it for the money. They're like, oh, if I become an entrepreneur, I could get really rich. Your expected value from becoming an entrepreneur is far lower than your expected value in your corporate job. So the number one thing to evaluate is what gives you personal happiness. What do you want to actually do? Because You know, I think entrepreneurship is great. And I think the fact that more and more people are getting into it is a is an awesome thing. What separates them, I don't know, but just, yeah, look, it's fast-paced, it's risk-taking, there's a lot of uncertainty. A lot of people can be intrapreneurs within an organisation as well. They're usually people who get inner fulfilment from achievement. So they don't get inner fulfilment from the fact that they successfully stayed in the office for 8 hours. They get inner fulfillment from what they achieved within those 8 hours. But look, like I said, just the general fact that more and more people are becoming interested in entrepreneurship is a great thing, because there's some sad stuff happening in our society and in the media in general, whereby, you know, the businessman or the entrepreneur has always been the evil guy. If you look at any movie, there's an evil entrepreneur usually. You know, the entrepreneur is never the hero. The entrepreneur is the evil guy smoking a cigar in the penthouse, running a pharmaceutical company. Like, that's the entrepreneur out there. Nobody talks about the fact that every single product or service that enhances our lives, there's an entrepreneur behind it losing sleep, thinking, how do I make it better? Whether it's the clothes that we're wearing, or the projector, or the people who built this building, or the guy who laid these floors, or you know, the people who made the microphone, or our smartphone, or the transportation you used to get here, or the medicine you bought at the pharmacy to make you feel better. Like, every single product or service that enhances our lives, there's an entrepreneur behind it losing sleep thinking, how do I make it better, all in the name of the pursuit of profit. So it's the pursuit of profit that enabled Richard Branson to make flights more affordable for everyone. The pursuit of profit that made Kerry Packer, the late and great Kerry Packer, give us great entertainment like one day cricket. It's the pursuit of profit that enabled the late and great Steve Jobs to let my mum send a text message for the first time ever. Now, she had a Nokia for 10 years and I bought her an iPhone, and I was like, Mum, how is it? She's like, oh, it's amazing, I can send text messages. She could never work out how to type on her Nokia. Like, you know, entrepreneurship achieves great things, and the fact that it's coming out of society now and a lot of people recognising and want to be involved is an amazing thing.
We'll take one last question. We kind of touched on the Ivan Orman stuff, but so I want to ask the second one, both the same votes. Rumours about a potential IPO with the ASX, and is that something that's happened, or what's holding you back?
Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah, I acknowledge that there are rumours about a potential Kogan IPO, and one day it's a definite possibility. There was an interesting question on there that's now off the screen, but do we have 5 minutes to answer it? It was a question about how we select our products, and it was saying, what methodology do you use to decide what to sell? And that's an interesting question, because philosophically I'm an objectivist. So every decision in the Kogan business is data driven. It's driven based on information and actual facts. Now, traditionally, companies would do market research by putting people in a room around a table and say, oh, well, what are you interested in buying? And one person would say, oh, I'm interested in buying shoes at the moment. And then 9 other sheep would say, yeah, I'm also interested in buying shoes. And then someone would produce a 100-page report about how people are really looking to buy shoes at the moment. And then retailers would pay big bucks for those reports. These days we have way better information. So a lot of these decisions at Kogan are based scientifically on your search patterns. So we monitor how many people search which terms on a daily basis and what starts to trend. So we've got data analytics teams sitting there looking at what's trending up, what's trending down, what new products to get, what products it's time to discontinue. And it's been an exact science. We know when we manufacture 32-inch TVs, how many to make with built-in DVD players, how many to make with built-in Blu-ray players, and how many 40-inch TVs to make. We know as an exact science based on people's Google searches. And that's data that Google makes publicly available. And it's so accurate because it's brain to keyboard with no filter. When you sit behind a Google window, you are 100% completely honest about what's on your mind right now. And that is how we can ensure efficiency in our business. It's one of our one percenters. Because of this, we never have aged stock, we never over order, we never under order. Our inventory management is near perfect. And to any entrepreneur out there in any field, should be very closely monitoring data and statistics and make decisions on actual facts rather on emotion or any other factor.
I'm going to ask one question myself too. You got all those startups here in the room. Is there guys who come pitch you stuff? Is there stuff that you would look to invest in?
Yeah, look, I've got a portfolio of quite a few businesses other than Kogan. Obviously Kogan's my passion, it's what I spend all of my time on, and I try to take as much time out of my day to meet with budding entrepreneurs as I can. And look, honestly, most of the ideas I get pitched are shit. Like, there'll be 99% rubbish, and every now and then there'll be a really good idea. And I evaluate a good idea on three key metrics. One is, what is your competitive advantage? So what sets you apart from everybody else in the marketplace? What do you do better than them? The second one is, what is your value add to the consumer? You know, does your consumer actually want what you're selling? The product or the service. There's no point in having a competitive advantage at being, you know, the cheapest pink pillars in the world when nobody's looking to buy pink pillars. Like, competitive advantage, value add to the consumer. And the third one is, do most people think you're crazy? And the reason that one's important is because if people think you and your idea are crazy, it means you're challenging the status quo the right amount to make a difference. So they're the three key things.
Nice. I want everyone back on their feet again. We need a big one. Thank you to Dominic.